Dunkin' Donuts? No, Dunkin' Kerbals. Hello everybody and welcome. Today we're going to do a deep dive into the new science gameplay of Kerbal Space Program 2 version 0.20, which was released earlier this week. In my overview video, I didn't have enough time to talk about all the details surrounding the science parts and science functionalities as I would have liked, because there were so much other things to talk about. I've linked that video up top and in the description, go check it out if you haven't yet. First, I'll explain all the new science parts and how they are different from how it was in the original KSP1. Then we're going to talk about actually using them, how to bring back science, and what nodes best to spend your points in the tech tree. If you enjoy space-related content and or the games Kerbal Space Program and Kerbal Space Program 2, make sure you're subscribed to this channel. There's a lot more content coming over the course of the next weeks. I am closing in on 10 years on YouTube and my goal is to finally reach 100,000 subscribers until April. Can you help me with that? I'd appreciate it a lot. But now, the science. First, science parts. Once everything is unlocked, you will have 9 different experiments that you can put on your spaceships. I will go through them in the order that you unlock them. First, the Science Junior. It shrunk compared to the part of the same name in KSP1 and is the first science part you can unlock. Up until you get it, you can only perform crew observations and collect samples by hand. The second part you unlock is a smaller version of the Science Junior called the Science Junior Junior. It weighs just 50 kilograms compared to the former's 1000 kilograms and can fit in a small cargo bay, leaving room for other goodies like batteries or an antenna. We'll talk about why you will need an antenna a little bit later. There's basically no need to bring the bigger Science Junior along once you unlock the smaller one, because both will perform the same experiment. You heard that right, science parts in KSP2 are partially interchangeable. We have 3 pairs of parts that do the same thing. The Science Junior siblings are the first one. And they are all the science equipment you can unlock in Tier 1 of the tech tree, but in Tier 2 you get access to atmospheric science packages. One in form of a nose cone, the other a little package to attach to your vehicles. I believe the developers made a mistake here, because the nose cone is so much heavier than the other part and performs the same experiment, I can't see how you would ever want to use it. But the game is still in early access, so this is surely subject to change. At least I hope so. What makes these atmosphere experiments stand out from the environment analysis of the Science Juniors is the fact that they need to run for quite a while. Gone are the days where you would dip into Joule's atmosphere for half a second and grab all available atmosphere science points doing so. You really need to remain flying, hovering or falling slowly for 2 minutes before the points are counted. Another part you unlock in Tier 2 is the Surface Sample Collection Arm. Unfortunately, it's a bit buggy right now and will only extend in one specific way. It does not appear to be aware of its surroundings, so be careful when placing it on your vehicles until that is fixed. But it does have its uses, because with it you can perform the same surface sample analysis that usually requires a Kerbal. With this you can land on more difficult bodies like Eve and transmit the surface sample data, but not the samples, we're getting to that, until you're capable of doing a real return mission. Maybe not with 10 Kerbals at once. Next up is the Radiation Science Package. It is unlocked in Tier 3, same as the Star Lab, an orbital survey experiment. In order to talk about this, I need to jump to Tier 4, where we have the Orbital Survey Package. It basically does the same as Star Lab, but is not as heavy and does not require 2 Kerbals to perform its experiments. But it does require a steady stream of electricity to work. So there is a trade-off, either bring more mass and 2 more crew members, but save power, or you can go smaller form factor, but need to watch your power budget. Both take 6 minutes to perform their experiments. And finally we have the You Dunk It, basically a 3-ton diving bell. Dunkin' Donuts? No, Dunkin' Kerbals, because this needs a crew member to work and it also needs to be submerged in liquid. Which means there's only a limited number of celestial bodies where you can actually use it. Kerbin, Eve, Lathe and Val. For everything else, you need to find a mix of the parts listed above suited for the mission you want to perform. So to summarize, we have a pair of environment science parts, of which one is obsolete once you unlock the second one. We have a pair of atmospheric sensors, where in my opinion only one makes sense right now, but that can change in the future. We have a pair of orbital survey parts, one large and crude, the other small, autonomous and power hungry. And then there's radiation science, sample collection and the liquid environment experiment. Now that we know how these work, let's talk about using science. Already at the first second you enter flight mode, you will see the science collection icon on the left flash. This is the indicator that you have a new science opportunity. Clicking it performs all available experiments and you can see the results in the research app that's popping up after completion. Notice that you're always going to have experiment results split up into data and samples. The first you can transmit back home, and that's what you're going to need the antenna for when you get further away from Kerbin. The second you have to return to reap the rewards and spend the points on new nodes in the tech tree. So no matter the experiment, there is always going to be a benefit to returning vehicles back home to Kerbin. Some experiments take a little bit longer to perform, for instance the atmosphere science part that we talked about earlier. In this case, the science icon on the left will keep pulsating green until the experiment is done. You can also check the timer in the parts manager by right-clicking on it. Only after the set timer is finished will you see the results in your research window. Now, this is all pretty straightforward when we're working with simple craft. One capsule or probe core with all the experiments on it. But what happens when you have more complex vehicles with a crew stage and lander, or a complex Jewel 5 behemoth with multiple smaller craft separating? Here's the thing. Sharing is caring. Every part that can carry science data and samples automatically receives all of it once the experiment is performed. Here we have two probe cores, but only one of them has the science part attached. I performed the experiment and detached the second core. When I switched to it, it has retained all science points that originally were in the combined vessel. Unlike in the original game, there is never going to be a situation where you will forget which part of the vessel contains all the science when you separate stuff from it. On the other hand, I'm not fully convinced it's a good idea to do this with samples. I mean, data, sure, if you can transmit it, you can copy it to every hard drive in your vehicle. Instant backups? Count me in. But physical experiment samples? I don't know. I spoke with the developers about this and one of them said that in his mind, the Kerbal slice up the samples into smaller pieces and distribute them among the probe cores and crew capsules of their vehicles. I mean, it's not too far-fetched, but it also shows a bit of a tendency to babysit players. What do you think? Does that make science collection a little bit too easy? Or is this sample cloning, with a capital K of course, a good improvement over the original KSP? Let me know in the comments down below. Okay, now that we have talked about the parts themselves and how to use them, let's talk about where to use them. Discovering things. Kerbal Space Program 2 continues the tradition that the first game began and asks players to visit multiple locations to gather additional science. In the old game, it was called biomes. Now the official term is regions. For instance, if you take the Kerbal Space Center, it itself is a region. The ocean next to it is another. The green hills west of it is yet another, and so on and so forth. Basically, if something on the map looks geographically different from other parts, it probably results in new science points for you. But aside from using your eyeballs, I haven't seen a reliable way to discern one region from another. Yes, you can hover your mouse over the science alert icon because it will show you where you are. But I guess it can get quite fatiguing to walk around or drive around or fly around for kilometers until you hit a new region. In KSP1 we had the KerbNet feature for probe cores. It would show biomes from orbit and enabled players to set waypoints so you could better plan where to land and where to explore. This is painfully absent in KSP2, at least so far. Keep in mind the game is still in early access, so there's surely more to come over the coming months. In addition to different regions, you can also get science points by visiting special landmarks, which are scattered across each celestial body. From what the developers told us, there should be dozens of these around the solar system. I already mentioned one of them in my overview video on Tuesday, this little thing called Capy Rock, named for the capybara-like shape it apparently has. There's also Stargazer Point, which was present in the promotional material, as well as this huge thing on lathe, and likely many more. Finding all those discoverables is going to be a needle in the haystack kind of search without some way to pinpoint them from orbit. At least let us set custom waypoints to follow if we see something weird and want to investigate it, because that's also something that's not possible right now, unfortunately. But once you've finally got some juicy new science points, it's time to use them. And that means upgrading your tech. The 4 Science update also introduces a tech tree to the game. It is split into 4 tiers, representing how you move from your home planet further outward into the solar system. Since science points are a finite resource, what should you spend them on? Well, this is really a bit of a question of personal preference, because me, I prefer to do rocketry compared to planes, but your tastes may differ. However, you should aim to unlock new science parts first, because those will enable you to gather more points per mission you undertake. To get the most out of your expeditions, try to bring the most science parts to the furthest reaches of the solar system, and then also make sure to return it all for the highest rewards. Me, I didn't try to max out the tech tree as quickly as possible, I just played to have fun. And I did have fun. With that approach, I ended up about a third into tier 3 after a bit over 35 hours of time in the game. Since it is already out for a few days, who of you out there has already unlocked everything without using the cheat menu? How long have you been able to play and how far have you come? Let me know in the comments below, I'm really interested. I hope this video has helped you better understand the mechanics of KSP2's science system. And if you want to purchase the game, but thought it was too expensive up until now, it is currently 20% off until January 4th, 2024. Me, I am still trying to figure out how to do a big Jewel 5 mission with all the new parts. I like that the game challenges my brain this way. As I said before, I'm having fun here. And that's why I'm going to stop recording this video and resume playing. If you enjoyed this video, please subscribe to my channel for more and follow me on my social thingies. The links are in the description. Thanks for watching. Goodbye.